Alrighty, it looks like I just got the thumbs up, so we can get going. Before I start in, can I get just a quick show of hands? How many of you in the audience label yourselves in your resume or when talking to clients as a developer versus some other job type? Alright, so we're about 50-50 split. Okay, so just so you know, those of you who didn't raise your hand, it's okay, you don't have to leave, it's no problem. This is geared to be a beginner-level developer talk, so there's going to be stuff for those of you who are experts in WordPress, there's going to be stuff for those of you who are relatively new to the ecosystem, no problem there. There is going to be a lot on screen, and this is going to be unlike most talks in that the reason there's a link on every single slide is that use the slides to reference. There's a lot of information here, and a lot of it's going to be really useful to reference in the future. I'm not going to read over everything. I'm going to skip over some things, but the slides are going to be available online in perpetuity. All right, so to get started, if my clicker will work.
I have to click on this first.
How often I do this? So I'm Greg Schoppe. I'm lead developer at Bytesco. Bytesco is a Burlington, Vermont-based digital marketing agency. We also have offices in Portland, Maine. We have around 350 clients now who we host and develop large-scale enterprise WordPress solutions for. I'm somewhat known in the WordPress community online in reference to WP Tavern a couple days ago. Yeah, it's fun. This Bytesco, we went through all that stuff. I want to start off with what not to do. Now, there are occasional situations for any one of the examples that I give. They're valid and reasonable, but when structuring a WordPress site, these are the things that I have run into with clients a bunch of times where we've had to undo a lot of their work, redo things, fix things, to get them back to, honestly, a starting point. One of the easiest ones is figuring out what should be a post type. So WordPress is at its core a collection of objects. One of the primary ones is the post type. The post is a blog post, a page, a property, a client, a company, depending on what you want to store, what you want to archive, what you want to look through. In general, you want these to be an absolute base level unit. So there are situations where you might want two post types, one for sold properties and one for available properties if you're a real estate developer. But in almost every case, you're going to want properties. And you're going to want an option to choose whether they are sold or available, or possibly leased. Because you can think in the future that there are other options there that may need to be added. And if you're adding a post type to every one, you're complicating things. Same goes for taxonomies. Those are groupings. If you're trying to make everything a category, like these folks, who this is a theoretical duplicate of a site that I swear I saw a few weeks ago, where if you go to their posts archive, you would see team members, you would see services, and you would see locations all in one big archive jumbled together, because they didn't build separate categories and post types to hold things and separate them out into one single category, one single taxonomy of category. Huge blocks of short codes or HTML in your contents. Watch out for it. This partially goes for page builders that are based in short codes, but watch what you're making users type and what you're making users deal with. Someone who's a content editor, even if you're super savvy with WordPress and HTML, probably isn't. And editing this is very much counter to the whole idea that WordPress benefits. We're almost through these, I swear. This one is controversial. A lot of people use this to great effect on especially low-budget sites and short timelines. The template hierarchy in WordPress lets you put pages in your theme that are defined by the ID of the relevant post or the slug of the relevant post or category, in this case, or taxonomy term. Both of those things can be changed somewhat transparently by the user without them knowing that those will be tied to the contents of the page. So if you migrate hosts, if you have a custom template here for a page I-19 being a contact page, that all goes away. So if you move to another host, you get different IDs assigned when you transfer your database or your post exported there. And your users have no idea what's happened. Getting back to that is very complicated. Your slug, you can change that, and when you change it, it's just a text box. Nobody knows that that's going to change the theme. Use page templates, use meta fields and options and taxonomies. We'll go through all those in detail in a minute, but just do not rely on quirks of the structure of the system to be features for your users. And widget areas. This is an actual client side of ours that came to us many, many years ago, pre-built. That's the widget area section, and it scrolls onwards. That is not the end of it, that's not even the third. They had a million sections. They threw on widget logic, and they needed a million different sidebars for a million different sections. In general, I'm a fan of controlling your data where it's built. So if it controls a page, put it on the page editing screen. Relying on widgets, homepage widgets, you know, it's a gray area, people do that. If you've got a couple of big sections of your site, but different widgets in different sections, sure. If you're getting down to a per-page basis, you're doing way, way too much work, and people are shuffling around too much. And custom user interfaces. These aren't bad. Not individually, these are actually a very useful thing. They control what your client puts where, they let them know what to do in terms of views. But when they get out of hand, boy, do they get out of hand. This is client bars that want a very strict design control of everything on their site. So you can see there's about 1,000 color swatch options, image uploader options, spots where they can enter right, HTML for different sections. They have to spend several days training people for this site. And you know, it's not a good system. It's not something that's intuitive. It's not something that they can manage on their own. And that's the biggest benefit WordPress can offer to users and to clients is easy trainability, easy usability, and a familiar interface. So the more you stray, the worse. Doesn't mean you shouldn't stray. Custom meta fields, custom meta boxes, taxonomies, those are all things that aren't in WordPress core and are great. But watch it. This one happens a lot. People install Divi, they leave all the options enabled, they say, here's your site, guys, when you want to build a new page, just go for it. Most people creating content do not know the difference between good design and bad design. That's why in pretty much any business you walk into, you will see a flyer for a company softball team, or a bake sale, or something or other in the back room that has comic stands all over it, and space all the heck, and you do not ever want to look at it again in your life. Don't let a website become that. So you do want to put some level of control on content editors' design options. If they're choosing everything from font to color to size to alignment, the person who you hired to write a blog post is not necessarily the person you wrote to control your brand. So, you know, this is more of a warning thing. If you gave your site to Guy Fieri, what would happen? Keeping in mind, this is his favorite shirt. A couple good examples. One of these is not my client, and I'm guessing you can figure out which. This is what happens when you let somebody say, wouldn't it be cool if they throw everything they can at the page? These guys have sets of templates that give them specific options. They can string them together in any order they want to produce pages, but they have specific brand book requirements and they have specific brand book options. And by keeping them somewhat limited in design, we keep them on brand while remaining fresh from page to page. If you want to check out the prevention for me, that one's that side. This side is linkscars.com if you really like that design. It's kind of brutalist, it's kind of trendy. Go for it. I figured they're not in country so I can get away with showing it. So how to do it right. And this is how to do it, not necessarily right for a small brochure site. This is how to do it for a large site that's going to have hundreds of pages. It's going to have taxonomies that are going to be searched and filtered, that are going to have posts that need to be handled in new ways 2 years from now than how they're handled now. We're going to go through the different data structures one by one. I'm not going to touch on comments. And the reason I'm not going to touch on comments is mostly because there is exactly one custom situation where I've seen repurposing comments go well, and that's reviews. Almost every other situation where I've seen people attempt to modify comments to do something else, they have done something god-awful. In general, comments work really well as comments on posts. They work reasonably well as reviews on posts. Kind of like me. We're also going to touch on links, which are archaic, dead, and you will probably never see, but they're interesting. Almost everything's a post. Your posts are posts. Your pages are posts. Your menu items are posts. Your attachments are posts. You are dealing with posts in a lot of the WordPress interface, whether or not you know it. So when you're thinking about what's a custom thing going to be that you're adding, it's most likely a post. And they are individual items that are defining collections by other types of collections. So they in themselves are not a collection, they are an item, they're a base thing. They are a staff member, they are a location, they are a product. The modifiers on posts are your taxonomies and your meta fields, and we'll run into those much more later. The big downside to our cross-searching, cross-filtering, using things from other ways later to a post is that the main content of that post, the body of it, the blog content, page content, etc., is most often stored in a single blob of HTML. With Gutenberg, you get some structure added into that as they insert the comments system that you've seen in our Kickstarter, where you can separate out blocks, you can parse them, page view, you can deal with them. But to MySQL, to queries, that's still an undifferentiated block, still unknown. So it's a little bit of the Wild West thing. So you want to figure out how much of your post needs to be content and how much it needs to be structured data. So, and that's the cut. Nice thing is, you get a great interface for featured images, title, author, all together. You get single posts, you get archives, all in one spot. Does a good job. We're not even going to bother going through all of these. Check out the slides for it. But a couple of good things on there. The events calendar. If you are doing events, do not try to roll your own events system. That way lies madness. There is so much to events in terms of just even just ordering them by date, having multiple per day, and building the templates necessary for them. Let someone else do that job. Relevancy, research results, does an excellent job of stripping things like formatting tags out of WP content and allowing you to add other things into your searches to make searching through posts very effective. And if you're worried about using any sort of service that counts your number of pages and charges you by it, as I heard someone mention yesterday, or if you're worried about your SEO, attachment post type has an archive. You've seen it as linked to the page for this image, as in the media library. That is mostly unwanted. Unless you are in a very specific situation where you want people commenting on specific images, grading specific images, or doing tasks like downloading and purchasing them, it's probably a good idea to disable it because it ends up often being an unstyled kind of, it becomes unwanted and it becomes something that people aren't attentive to in terms of design or SEO. Users. Unless you need authentication, unless you need people to log in and do stuff as a person, don't make them a user. Users have permissions, whether or not they are assigned permissions, because plugins are not always necessarily great about giving them permissions and limiting their permissions. So it is a very good idea to keep in mind that every user-based option you add is a potential risk to your site. So if users can create content, if they can upload images, very notably with 497's fix, the things that users can do are useful. And if you need, you know, commenting is authenticated. If you need forums, then users by all means, can you buddy press? If you need people to go in and be able to post content as editors, users. If you don't need authentication, don't make a user. And, you know, common ones, forum members, employees, customers. Interesting factoid, there are two roles here, administrator and editor. One thing that a lot of people believe right off the cuff is that the administrator has complete control of the site and the editor has only the power to create posts, upload images. They can't change options, they're relatively safe for them. Important to note, both of those can load unfiltered HTML onto a site. And because of that, the editor user, if they are a malicious actor, can get administrative permissions. They are someone who can add JavaScript onto a page on your site that, when the administrator logs in, will make the editor an administrator. So, trust your editors. If you give someone the editor privilege, or if you give someone the unfiltered HTML privilege, be very, very careful. Users get these very nice profile images from Gravatar. That's built-in functionality. It's very nice. Gravatar's owned by Automattic. A lot of people don't actually know what Gravatar is or how to use it, so unless you want to explain it to all of your users, there's also some great plugins to add profile picture functionality where they can upload an image. Once again, the user can upload an image. Be careful about security. And be really careful about your plugins. If you're adding users, if you're letting public people log in, you are opening a door, and a lot of plugins out there do not properly close it. Tips, once again, go through slides. It's meant to be a resource. There's a lot of links in there. This one, I was really thinking I was going to cut, thinking I was going to leave. Advanced Access Manager is a really bulky piece of software. It does hurt your performance. And it is something that does a lot with permissions, and as such, you have to trust it very explicitly to be safe. But it is extremely handy in building editing workflows, deciding who can save a post, who can edit a post, who can change things. Beyond that, in my login, just like a month ago, started selling a pro version that breaks up a lot of their great features into little packets that cost more. So it's not that hard to roll your own, but it is still the best one out there for theming your login and integrating into your site. Talk about the avatar. And this is an interesting one. If you want to have a profile page for your users, you don't care what they publish, you don't want to show a blog, you just want to have a profile page. Keep in mind the author template, which is the default template for showing a user profile, is an archive. So it pulls in all posts related to that user, whether you want them or not. So if you're really worried about database performance on a big site, build a custom template, use custom permalink structure so that you don't have that query going on, because if you don't need it, it's just access. We're going to touch on this just for a second. WordPress used to have a blog roll. Blog rolls were cool. You could show your favorite sites in a big long list. You could categorize them. That went away two major revisions ago, and by and large, it's completely forgotten. If you need to show favorite links, if you're interested in just categorizing a list of things you find cool on the web, turn it back on. It's just disabled. There is a really simple one-liner or a feature plugin, which this is going to show that it's really out of date. That shows how many people use the links functionality. But simple one-liner to re-enable it. And if all you need is just a list of favorites, don't bother using a post or using you know, a larger data structure for it, because that's really lightweight. Doesn't look too great on the back end, though. It is kind of WordPress 2.0. Oh. It's got XFM data. Don't know if anybody's had of that in the last few years. So, it's there. So, terms. We're almost through. We're on 4 out of 10. So terms are the third basic object type beside users and posts. I am not going to include links in that because it's deprecated. They are how you organize together posts, put them in groups, find them later, show them all together, and filter by them very quickly. They cache a count of the number of things that are stored in a term. term. Terms are grouped in taxonomies. If you want to think about it really easily, it's categories. You are categorizing something. The problem is that you've already got a thing called categories, so you need something else. If you want colors to be one type of group, that needs to be a taxonomy. You can't just call it a category, you've already got the category. Terms are an item in that. So blue would be a term in the colors category. Administrator would be a term in the job title category. They're optimized for fast archive queries and term queries. They are not optimized for being queried on single posts and multiple times. So if you need to grab like all the terms related to something 50 times on one post page, not optimized for that. It's going to be a little slow. Post times better. When you save and update terms, they update a count on every single term that you have changed or touched since the last time you saved. If you have 20,000 terms in a taxonomy, if you change one of those on a post, then you update the counts for the number of posts in 20,000 terms. That can be incredibly slow. So if you are building a large site, if you do not need to count those, you can turn it off entirely with a WP deferred term counting function. You can turn that off, or you can turn it off and then turn it back on at the end of a script. So if you have to update 50 terms and 50 taxonomies, turn it off, do an update, turn it back on at the end, and it'll recount once. If you don't do that, every time you update your terms, it recounts over and over and over and over. We have a client who sells monitoring components. They have 200,000 products or so with all of their variations and such. If they change a category, it was a bit of a nightmare. They hit save and wait 20 minutes. Deferred term counting makes that a lot faster. Still not super fast, but it's better than that. Terms are also objects. Terms can be attached not just to posts, they can be attached to any object. So you can attach them to users. There's no user interface for it, but you can do it, and it's kind of cool. You can categorize your users, you can categorize your posts, you can technically categorize your terms. That way lights badness. Don't add terms to terms, please. Metadata. So metadata is a key value store attached to every post that lets you drop anything you want into the post. So you can say, my metadata is name, and my value is Craig Schoppe, and his value is John, and his value is Steve. You can store data structures like classes and arrays. And you can store Boolean values like true and false. It becomes very useful for flagging, it becomes very useful for filtering. You can also store numeric values, which makes it easy to do searches where you want to find someone who's older than 35 in your data structure. Which all comes in very, very handy. They're associated with posts. You can also associate meta with terms. You can also associate meta with users. You normally hear about it on posts, but there's no particular reason you can't store a text area of even rich text format with your taxonomy terms. You can have the color blue have a nice pretty page that describes the color blue before it shows in the art. Hopefully you describe the color blue, but some people. There's a lot of post meta that WordPress builds in automatically. The one I want to call attention to is featured image. The featured image on every post, which is a default option, you can turn on and off, but on most post types it's going to be there, is pulled in with from post. And the reason that matters is that post meta provides a catch. For the fastest operation of post meta, when you pull in your first metadata value for a post, all of the metadata for that post is cached in memory for WordPress for that run. So that's a great way to make sure that you don't have to go back to the database and make additional queries just to get first name, last name, and job type. Thing is, featured image is almost always called on an archive page where there are 20 posts, or 30 posts, or 40 posts, or 100. Normally not a problem, but if you are someone who likes to store a large amount of data in post meta, if you want to have the archives of every test you have ever run on the emissions of a vehicle, in your post meta for a single post, you may have megabytes of data that gets pulled from the database into that cache for every single post on your archive page on every single page load. It's not that fast. And the interesting thing about it is there's not a standardized way to disable that cache in any specific call. So really, the important thing is keep your metadata slim. Make sure that you don't throw huge amounts of unnecessary data into post meta, term meta, or user meta, because when you're showing archives, you will run into problems the minute you start storing huge amounts of data. We have a client who does art licensing. This client has 27,000 pieces of art in their database, and at one point they had a big serialized blob of all the information about the art that was, maybe 200K per post stored in post meta. And anytime you viewed an archive page, it will just hang. You remove that, you store only the data you need, suddenly things are fast. It's also important to note that so that you can store numbers, strings, arrays, booleans, anything you want in post meta, WordPress runs these functions, maybe serialized and maybe unserialized. These are the bane of my existence. They are the functions that keep me up at night worrying, because they use a function called isSerialized. And isSerialized is phenomenal in that it doesn't check if a string is actually serialized data. It runs a few regular expressions on it and says, good enough. And as such, you can end up in situations where if you save something to post-meta and get it back, you might not get back what you saved. So it's really important to be careful with what you save. If you're saving something that is a serialized string or looks like a serialized string, the default recommendation for a lot of people is just to encode it with like basics before encoding or similar. That's not a great answer, because you can't search for that, you can't sort it. Simple data structures, thin layers, try not to store massive amounts of stuff in your post meta. Talk about that. This is an interesting one. On your post meta edit screen, WordPress by default adds blocks. That blocks is called custom fields, and it is a really easy interface to add your own post meta or remove post meta, or metadata blocks. But it runs a query that shows all meta fields that are on any posts, so that you can easily see what you've used before and fill in the stuff next to it. Seems good enough. Problem is, it tries to hide anything that begins with an underscore, so that it doesn't show any of your hidden meta fields. A query for a not like on an unindexed table for our metadata is incredibly slow for a large table. This same client that had a lot of metadata ended up having their edit page before optimization take a couple of minutes to load, because it had to run a query to get every piece of metadata to figure out whether the name started with an underscore, and if it didn't, to list them out in that little table. Even though it was a disabled feature on the admin page, it still runs the query. So there's the filter there. You can put it in your functions. If you are never going to use the custom fields box that's built into WordPress, if you've got a big site, do it. If you've got a small site, don't worry about it. But if you're talking in the thousands of posts, it will speed up your process. This one is going to be extremely contentious. I am not a fan of ACF, and everyone here who uses ACF probably hates me for saying that. But I am of the opinion that, for the same reason that naming templates with -19 to target post 19, or to name templates -cheese to target the post named cheese, it is a bad idea to do that because the user doesn't control it. It's also a bad idea to have a user interface that sets the slugs to your post meta when you're going to call that and use it in templates without the user's control. People may not care about that. It may be functional, but from a best practices case, carbon fields allows you to find all that in code. Now, to ACF's credit, you can import the structure of your post meta from a JSON file. It's usable, still pulls from the database, you can still edit it on the back end without some modifications. Still not a huge fan, I like carbon fields. But I can be argued about that afterwards. I know people like to. And then the super weird one, beware the safing functions that WordPress implements for MySQL. The escape SQL and prepare functions WordPress implements occasionally with oddly specific lists of percentages and slashes in your host meta will not return the same value you saved in. So if you saved in %%%%%, etc., and it happens to match up with one of the filler delineators that WordPress puts in the string, it will get lost. So you have to be very careful about that. Options tables. For larger sites, I honestly recommend not storing all that much in options. The customizer stores everything in options, widgets store everything in options, and your admin panel stores everything in options. For larger, more custom sites, if you're worried about performance, a lot of that stuff can be hard-coded and doesn't need to be chosen. Where it does need to be chosen, if it's not related to a single post, it goes in options. If it is related to a single post, it goes in post meta and the others. It also has the same issue with serialized. Maybe serialized, maybe unserialized, applies most. So your data that goes in may not be the same as comes out. Be careful about how complex the data is to put into options. Also, serialized data in the array. If you put an array, into the database, then you try to store that. It will serialize it with PHP serialize, and if you try to edit that as a string, it will break. If you do that with the widget area, it will break your site. So do not try to do a find and replace on your entire database to change one line of text to another, like a site URL. Use instead Better Search and Replace plugin or WPCLI. Those are great tools that'll do it, take care of it, and it'll take care of your serialized data. Make sure your site doesn't break. Page builders. So I mentioned earlier how host data is normally stored in an undifferentiated blob HTML. Most page builders add into that. Now, that doesn't mean there's not a great use for them. Page builders can be very useful for styling content, making pages look unique, and doing individual things with them. If you are trying to store structured data or information that really matters inside a page builder, you are going to have trouble referencing other places, pulling it out and querying. So you have to be extremely cautious when using a page builder to decide how much of your site you want that page builder to control. Just throwing Divion and designing all the pages is going to get you in trouble. This is a search result from Visual Composer. It's interesting to note none of these search results have the word column in the page at all, but it shows up in the search results because they use the short code column. And the short code column is search. This is Gutenberg. I love Gutenberg. I think that it's going to be a great thing. I went to a talk yesterday about how to use it in a very chunked, very detailed manner. It was wonderful. But one thing to be cautious of, your Gutenberg comments, like column or like image, end up in search results because you just searched the post contents blog and those comments are part of that. Relevancy can help you with that. Building a search cache custom can help you with that. Third-party search plugins can, but the default WordPress search is going to get interested with that. This talk yesterday, if you weren't here, go back in time, go to this talk. If you weren't there, you're good. If you weren't there, the slides are online. just look at the WordCamp Boston page, it's in there. This was fantastic. It's how to leverage Gutenberg for structured data. Gutenberg in and of itself is not going to, you know, structure your data, throw it into meta fields, show you how to tag things, change your taxonomies, build custom post types, etc. But fantastic talk from yesterday about how to do so. I'm not going to try and do it. Bidirectional relationships. This is a many-to-many relationship. It's one thing WordPress cannot do. Not built into it. And that means related posts are really kind of hacky in WordPress. They're attached to one single post, but you don't see. So if my post about my dog is related to some cat, my post about my cat is not related to my post about some of the dog. So there are plugins to do this. There aren't any good ones. There's the idea of storing it one way, which is what most related post plugins and themes do. the idea of scoring two different meta values, one on each post, which is what some systems do, and it doesn't work all that well because they get out of sync, and you have one that thinks it's on the other and doesn't think it's on the first. You need a many data structure where you can store data that shows up on both sides of the movie and the actor. You can store additional meta on. In the real world, actors have roles attached to movies, attached to actors who have roles. Where real world employees work in offices, they have a role at that office, a start date and end date, they might change. Pause framework tries it, tool sets tries it. They do okay. They store meta in both directions, they store a verification table that tries to match them to make sure they don't break. It still breaks. Post connector does it okay if you can relate, they don't give you any meta. Post to post is pretty good, gives you a relationship, gives you meta, but it also hasn't been updated in 3 years. It's probably going to break the Gutenberg interface because it uses really old HTML and JavaScript. I'm working on one. It'll be out in a couple months. It's not out now, but you can check out the backend code using for super advanced stuff if you're interested, or just follow me on Twitter. Custom tables. So sometimes the WordPress data structure isn't enough. Specifically with searches, very often you need to use a flat data structure, not a relational data structure to get fast searches. So in this case, we have products, we want filters, we want to be able to count, we want to be able to enable these filters and disable them if there are products under them or not under them. It'd be really slow to do relational queries for this with terms and post meta and posts. So we have a table that has every single option available for every single product in one single flat table with just a Boolean value of whether they have it or not. You can do searches on that really fast. And it's great. You can flat it out, you can then grab your post ID, and you can go back and you can show the posts that are relevant or not relevant. Problem is, if that data gets out of date, it no longer matches up with the posts, and your filters don't work. So you've got to be really careful about rebuilding that patch when you need to. External data stores. Another answer to the same thing about searching and filtering is to use an external data store that is not MySQL. MySQL is not great at that kind of query, so you can use Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is great at that kind of query. You can plug it in with a plugin called ElasticPress. It works really well. You can use Redis for caching objects. Plug it into WordPress. It works really well. Good idea. Last bits I've got, that may be serialized, may be unserialized. If it really throws you for a lark and you're having trouble with it, got some functions linked there that basically duplicate the original meta and options functions that have that problem, only without the serialized bit. You just send them strings and make sure it's always a string. You're good. And the escaping functions can cause problems for JSON objects. I wish I had a magic bullet for that. I wish I could include a snippet for that. That is an outstanding issue. It's something that if any of you developers have spare time and are interested in working on core, do it. Improve it. Make it better. Best thing about WordPress is we can commit. That's Savannah, she's my part-time dog. So I've probably got about 2 minutes for questions, but I'll also be at the happiness bar after for any additional questions. Anybody wants to know? Or does everyone hate me already?